the word of God. Psalm 90, verse 12. Psalm 90, verse 12. They so teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. I pray that we will have the time to conclude the sermon today. But it's also my prayer that by reason of this sermon, your lives will never be the same again.
Amen.
Let us invite the Lord with a song, "You Are Alpha and Omega."
You are Alpha. It's a gift that has an expiry date. Because it has a beginning, it must have an end. And there is no exception. Everyone that is born shall die. But we know the fact that it's a gift with an expiry date,
The expiry date is unknown. You don't know when it will expire. Or like you buy a drug or you buy something and they tell you best by so-so date. The expiry date for our lives is kept a secret with God. God deliberately refused to let us know when we will go back to Him, so that we can live each day as if it could be the last. We then went to point number two, that because of this reason, you must handle the life with care. You must handle it with care by following the manual. There is a manual for handling life. That manual is called the Bible. You live your life outside of the Bible, you are inviting trouble to your life. There is no alternative. You cannot have joy outside of Christ. You can have happiness, but happiness doesn't last. No one, no human being can have joy outside of Christ. And that's why I explained to you, joy has nothing to do with money. Has nothing to do with wealth, has nothing to do with your circumstance. And I give you the example that the highest suicide rate in the world is in Japan. They are one of the richest countries in the world, very wealthy country, and they live long. An average Japanese will live 80 years, at the minimum 80 years. In Nigeria, average life expectancy of a Nigerian is 47, 46. So a Nigerian dies on average in their 40s. Well, a Japanese on average will live to be 80 plus in wealth, in affluence, and yet they are committing suicide. What does that say to you? Joy has nothing to do with your circumstance. It's about Christ in you, the hope of glory. That's why if you want to have a joy in your life, if you want to have life that is filled with joy, you have to live your life according to the manual called the Bible. I've shared with you the example of a couple that I had the privilege to go and counsel with them several years ago, almost 12 years ago now. And they were quarreling, the husband and wife, and we were trying to just mediate. And remember what I told you, the husband said, well, we said to the couple, let us turn to this passage. And the husband said, please leave the Bible alone for now, please leave the Bible alone for now. If we leave the Bible alone for now, what is left? So we just leave the Bible alone for now. You will never say that in Jesus' name. But when the Bible is gone, there's nothing left. So we went to point number three last week. That because of this, you must love more deeply. Love while you have the opportunity to love. I said, don't worry, I will be better next year. I'll be a better person. I will love more. You may not be there next year. Love more deeply while you have the time to love. And that's why I explained to you using Matthew chapter 5, even love those that are unlovable. But many of us only want to love the people that are nice, want to love the people that are kind to you, want to love people who love you. But the Bible says God makes a sun to rise on the good and on the evil, and he sends his rain to the bad and to the good. If God blesses all of us, whether we are nice or bad, you also need to learn to love other people, whether they are good or evil. I rounded up last Sunday with the fourth point, which is forgive more readily. If you want to enjoy life, if you want to handle this life that is shaken, but truly our life is fragile, If you want to handle it with care, you must forgive more readily. Otherwise, you can cut short that life. That's why I explained to you, I know of a man, I know him personally, that died while he was angry, he was complaining, somebody did something wrong. In the process of complaining, he had a heart seizure and he died. Maybe the person that offended him was busy eating pandeyam, eforiro, was goat meat. I.e. that what was offended, they are still in jail with anger. The offender is enjoying life. You have to be extremely careful not to allow anger turn you to the stupid one. Because none of us shall be stupid in Jesus' name. Because you are losing twice. First, the person has offended you. And then you are now allowing that offense to also damage your soul. If for your own sake, if for your own interest, forgive that person for your own interest. So that you can be healthy and you can live long. Anger and malice results in hypertension. The results in ulcer. I'm not a doctor, but I've studied these things. You keep anger too much, you keep malice too much, you can have hypertension, you can have ulcer, it can kill you. The anger can kill you. That's why they say, undo with care. I want to share with you a few examples which you are probably aware of. I told you last Sunday, the Bible said in Proverbs 29:22. Let's read it together. Proverbs 29:22. And mark it in your Bible. Just mark it. Proverbs 29:22. And each time somebody offends you, go back to that passage. Each time somebody annoys you, go back to that passage. Proverbs 29:22. An angry man stirs up strife, and a furious man abounded in transgression. Let me break it down for you. The person who is angry will only end up causing more trouble. The person who is angry will not avoid going into transgression. If you are angry, there's almost 100% probability that you do something wrong. And you think about it, this time you are very angry. What do? You are thinking of vengeance. How can I show this person? You are thinking of very, very bad things. That's why the Bible says the furious man, the man that is angry, abounds in transgression. I'll give you two life examples. On February 12th this year, February 12th this year, there's a woman called Naomi. Naomi Chidiye Bere. She was 24 years old. I wanted to show her photograph. I said, let me not show you. It's too gory. Many of you probably read the story. February 12th this year, this Naomi of a woman, she got married 3 months earlier. 24 years old. Married a man, 34 years old. Their marriage was sweet, just 3 months old marriage. And then they had a simple argument. And the man went in search of petrol. Doused the woman with petrol and set her ablaze. The woman you just married 3 months ago, that everybody came to rejoice with you, you poured petrol on her and you set her ablaze. I'm sure after the woman died, that man's eye will now, with his own eyes, with his own hands, he burnt his wife because of anger. You say, how can that happen? You continue to be angry. Continue to be angry. God help you if there is no knife around. Before you know it, you become a murderer. You won't know. It's just the anger. Somebody offended you. You get somebody near you. Bam! You kill somebody. The furious man stumbles in transgression. If that is not enough, two Saturdays ago, on the 21st, a man in Enugu, I'm sure you probably read the story of Mrs. Moise. Another story, just 2 Saturdays ago in Enugu, the man gave the wife small money to cook some soup. And he got home, the woman decided to cook another soup. He was angry. Is it the soup I told you to cook? Grab, they say it in broken. No do. The man went in search of his God. Is this the soup I told you to cook? Wow. The woman is dead. She's dead. Just 2 Saturdays ago, small quarrel over is this the soup I asked you to cook? You wasted somebody's life over a small quarrel. Just 2 Saturdays ago. The angry man abounds in transgression. That's why I pray for you. The wisdom to conquer anger. The Almighty God will give unto you in Jesus' name. You know, Romans 12 verse 19 tells us, it says, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. No matter what anybody does to you, there is an impartial judge called God. God says, don't worry, let me settle this court. Don't worry. Leave it all to me. But you want to be the judge. You want to be the lawyer. You want to be the judge. You want to be the jailer. You want to be the executor. The Bible says, leave it to me. I will repay. Vengeance is mine. So if anybody does anything to you, pray for them if you love them. If you don't love them, leave them in the hands of God. I don't know if I have told you the story of the eagle. I'll tell you the story of the eagle today. 2 eagles. The Bible, I think I even heard it from General Basia. So, there's this story of the eagle. The eagle will send the baby eagle, the mother eagle sends the baby eagle, go and bring food. And it is, the baby eagle will look for the chickens. And will look for a stray chicken that has left the mother's cover. Grab the small chicken and fly back to give to the mother eagle. And the mother eagle asks on one occasion, what did the mother hen do when you carried the baby? The small eagle said, the mother shouted, flip-flap her wings. Shouted, you know the way the chicken shout when you carry the baby? Said, the mother hen shouted, flap. The mother eagle said, let us eat. So they ate the small chicken. On another day, she sent the baby eagle again, go and bring food. The baby eagle flew. And saw one small chicken left the mother. Bam! Carry it. When she got to the mother eagle, when you carry this small chicken, what did the mother do? Said the mother did nothing. She was just looking. The mother eagle said, take this chicken back now. If you carry the baby and the mother hen did nothing, take the chicken back now. Because the mother has handed you over to God. Does somebody get the message? If you try to fight yourself, how much can you fight? But when you leave them to God, that's when they are in trouble. I pray for you that the grace to conquer anger, the Almighty God, release unto you in Jesus' name. Amen. Point number five, give more generously. To handle this life with care, give more generously. Life is beautiful only when the pleasures of life are shared. When you share the pleasures of life, there is more joy. And you will live long because God will preserve you. God is not going to come down to bless people himself. He's going to use others to bless people. So when God finds somebody who is transferring the blessing, it will preserve your life because you have become the channel through which others are being blessed by God. But many of us handle this life too rigidly. We hold on to it. I was in there when I was working for my money. Does he know how hard I work? Praise the Lord. I say praise the Lord. Work hard. All that money you have accumulated, I want to see how much of it you will carry with you. They will play ludo without your money. After you die, they will play ludo and they will just put the money. But the Bible tells us very clearly, 1 Timothy chapter 6 verse 7. 1 Timothy chapter 6 verse 7 says, we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we will not take anything out. That money, hold it very well, keep it, put it in a safe, put it in smell. So watch over your money, make sure nobody comes near it. The day you die, we'll see how much you go with. And then people who did not know how you got your money, they will be drinking beer and they will take bets. Arsenal will beat Man U. I bet you 1 million naira. That's your money. They are bet you beat that money you work hard for. And of course, Arsenal will beat Man U 1 million as well. The following week, I can bet you Man City within Newcastle 10 million. You bet all your money away. Give more revenue. Give. While you have the opportunity, give. Use that money to bless somebody. Because you did not bring anything to this world. And as the Lord lives, you will not carry one cup out. When you give to others, you buy yourself an insurance policy. When you give, you buy this your life, this fragile life, you buy it an insurance policy. Because in the day of crisis, God will remember those good works. That's why it tells us in Acts of Apostles chapter 10 verse 4. The Bible said to Cornelius, Cornelius, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. All your prayers, all your harms, all the good things you have been doing for people, today God has decided to bring to remembrance. That's why I pray for those of you that are Libra. In the day of trouble, your good works, your kindness, your harms will speak for you in Jesus' name. Amen. Give more generously, because the opportunity may not come again. If you look at this passage, Matthew 25, verse 41 to 46, he says, the Lord will come one day, and then he will divide the world into two.
those on his right, he will say to them, enter into the rest of your Lord.
He called them the sheep.
To those to his left, says, enter into everlasting fire. And they said to him, Daddy, why are we going to enter into everlasting fire?
What have we done to enter into everlasting fire?
He said unto them, because when I was hungry,
you did not give me food.
When I was naked and I had no clothes to wear,
you did not give me clothes.
He said to them, when I was sick, you did not visit me. And the Bible said, if you go read that passage, they responded and said, when did we see you? When did we see you hungry and we did not give you food? When did we see you naked and we didn't give you clothes?
He looked at them
and said, for as long as you did not do it to any of the brethren around you,
you have not done it unto me. Many of us want to go to heaven, but many people don't know the road to heaven. You don't know the road. And that's why that passage makes it very clear. Those who take care of the hungry, those who take care of the naked, those who take care of the sick, those who take care of the lonely, they will enter into heaven.
Those who guard their money very well, it's my money, I work for it. You know how hard I work on Saturday and Sunday. Saturday and Sunday, there is hellfire as well.
7 days a week, hellfire as well.
None of you will enter hellfire in Jesus. Point number six, speak more kindly. Speak more kindly. Handle this life with care.
As we grow up in age, it's also good to grow up in wisdom.
Handle the life with care by speaking more kindly.
Proverbs chapter 15 verse 1 tells us that
a soft answer does what?
Turns away wrath. But grievous words stir up strife.
When you learn to speak softly, when you learn to speak calmly, you find out there's less trouble for you. There's less trouble for you when you speak calmly and softly. But the moment you speak aggressively, you find you are always quarreling. You are always quarreling with somebody because the person you speak harshly to will not keep quiet.
It will return into you in kind.
You say to somebody, why are you always stupid? What do you expect the person to say? God bless you, my sister. What do you expect the person to say?
Say, you call me stupid. You are hard.
Before you know it, there's fight everywhere, rock fight, the theater club. How did it start? Because somebody said you are stupid.
You speak softly, there's no problem, you won't have to fight. But the moment you don't control the words that come out of your mouth, you will always be quarreling. What you sow, you will be.
Oftentimes when I counsel married people, I just look at them and say, so when will this civil war end?
When will this civil war in your house end?
Say, this my wife never respects me. She's just useless. And the wife will say, hey, look at the man that he says somebody is useless. Even in front of me, they start another civil war. And if you are not careful, they will injure you. Why? They are speaking harsh words. Harsh words. You speak harsh words, you get harsh words.
But you honor the person you will be honored by. You honor your wife, she will honor you. You respect your wife, she will respect you. That's why I say, handle this life with care. There is enough trouble. Don't add to the trouble with your mouth. That's why I'm praying for somebody today. The grace to speak more kindly, God will give unto you in Jesus' name. I'll just mention a few passages and then I wrap up with the last one. Don't be an accuser. That's part of speaking kindly. Don't be an accuser. And don't be among those that condemn. Don't be among those that condemn. And don't be among those that have formed a profession of accusing. Because the Bible tells us that Jesus Christ, our Lord, when you study John 8 verse 11, they brought for him a woman that was caught in adultery. They said to the Lord Jesus, we saw this woman with our eyes. We saw her. There is no doubt she was in adultery. She has no reason to deny. All of them were accusing the woman. And then Jesus said, all right, whoever amongst you, all of you, if there is anyone who does not have any sin, let him be the first to throw stone at this woman. And all the accusers just let quietly. Even though they were accusing somebody, they themselves had their own sin. You need to remember that all the time, that each time you accuse somebody, you yourself, you are accused. An accused is accusing somebody. There is no human being that is perfect. None. I don't know of any human being. So you have to be careful before you make a profession of being an accuser. Ask your neighbor, what's your profession? Because some people, that's their job. That's their job. From morning till night, they're accusing somebody, they are complaining, they do it for a living. As the story concluded, after they left, they stopped throwing stone. None of them could throw stone. Jesus called the woman in that John 8, he said, where are your accusers? She looked around and said, I can't see them anymore. And Jesus said unto her, even I don't condemn you. Go and sin no more. Isn't that a nice thing? I can tell you that lady will not commit adultery anymore. Because somebody spoke to her with love. Said, I don't condemn you. Don't sin anymore. That is the way to correct somebody. You correct with love. You correct with knowing that you yourself, you are an accused. Psalm 130 verse 3 says, if God were to mark iniquity, who can stand? You that you are accusing somebody, if God were to mark it, even you will not be able to stand. That's why I said to the woman, I don't accuse you, but go and sin no more. I want to close with the final point. Draw closer unto God. Draw closer unto God. Draw closer unto God. To handle this life with care, you need to get close to God. Because He's the author of the manual of life. God is the only one that can take you from state to state and mold you into that perfect being. Do this life with care. Why did you need to draw close to God? I'll just tell you a story which you all know very well. But there are many of us that try to operate with our strength. I am strong. I am intelligent. I am hardworking. Praise the Lord for you. The Bible says in Luke 15,
When you study 12, verse 12 to 21, Luke 15:12-21, that was a very rich man, very successful businessman. The Bible said he came to a point one day and said, "This my store is too small. This my warehouse is too small. I will break down this warehouse. I will build a bigger warehouse where I can store things. And then when I have relaxed and everything is really nice, then I'll become born again." Like some people are saying, that when you tell them about Christ, they say, "Just leave that pattern for now." They want you to leave it for now. They are building bigger warehouse. But the Bible said, that night, that same night, God said to him, "Thy soul shall be required of thee, and we shall see whose will be those things that you have acquired." Many of us are busy chasing wealth, acquiring. Like I was in a session last week and I was saying to the people, "Have you listened to this sermon?" And give me excuse, "This one didn't work, the CD I had didn't work, this one down here." And you've been busy doing all that, you have the time to eat in the morning, in the afternoon, in the night, for every day since the last 3 months, but you did not have the time to listen to the passage. Nothing happened to prevent your breakfast, nothing happened to prevent your lunch, nothing happened to prevent your dinner, but something happened to prevent you from listening to the word of God. Be careful so that you don't become like that man that is building a bigger factory. Because at the end of the day, you can build the factory and may not be there to stop it. So get close to God, because our life is in His hands. I'll leave you with these passages. I'm out of time now. But study these passages on your own. Proverbs 21:31. Please study it on your own. The passage says, The horse is prepared for the day of battle, but safety is of the Lord. You can do all the burglary proof you want in this world. In fact, you can make your car bulletproof. Make your shoe bulletproof. Make your coat bulletproof. Make your trouser bulletproof. Make your hat bulletproof. God can kill you without even touching you. He doesn't need to fire any gun. He doesn't need any arm robber. He doesn't need any kidnapper. The Bible says he's a God that will catch you without running. That's why they say, draw close to God. The horse is prepared for the day of battle, but safety is of the Lord. Another passage I want to leave you with, John 15:5. It says, "Without God, we are nothing. Without God, we are absolutely nothing." 1 Samuel 2:6-9. I want to give you two more passages and then we close. 1 Samuel 2:6-9. Study it. Every day, study it. Yeah, the Bible says, "I am the God. I can kill and I can make alive. I am God. I can make poor and I can make rich." He goes on and says, "I am God. I can bring law. I can lift up." God. By that reason, no man by strength shall prosper. If you have not studied before, who has studied it? Without God, everything else is useless. That's why I want to close with this passage, and I want you to open it and circle it, underline it. If you have marker, mark it. So that whenever you begin to think, I can do this on my own.